I think it's terribly important that jazz is primarily dance music. So you move when you hear it. And it always moves in a direction of elegance, which is the most civilized thing that a human being can do. The ultimate extension, elaboration, and refinement of effort is elegance, where just doing it gives pleasure of itself. That's about as far as we can get with life. That's equivalent to what Ernest Hemingway called the sweat on a wine bottle. If you don't enjoy how those beads of sweat look, you know, when you pour the white wine out and you taste it and how your partner looks and how the sunlight comes through, you missed it.
January 1st, 1936. The swingos think that swing is marking an indelible notation on the evolution of jazz. With them, it's a creed, a code. That's why the swing addicts seem so glazed and dazed in their nth degree appreciation of this swing business. So what is swing? Ask any one of the swingoists and they will all vamp off. Well, swing is something like, but none seems able to define just what it is. Abel Green, Variety.
In the mid-1930s, as the Great Depression stubbornly refused to lift, jazz came as close as it has ever come to being America's popular music. It had a new name now, swing, and its impact was revolutionary. Swing rescued the recording industry. In 1932, just 10 million records had been sold in the United States. By 1939, that number would grow to 50 million. Swing, which had grown up in the dance halls of Harlem, would become the defining music for an entire generation of Americans.
I think that we all have a hankering for the music we were hearing when we were 14, 15, 16 years old. I think that never gets away from us. And with me, it was the swing bands. That was my music. This is where I was coming from. This was the thing that gripped my heart at the beginning. And it, as is the case with anybody, those things that you picked up early in your life are the ones you turn back to, you know, when you want a little solace.
People needed dance music maybe more than ever in America because the country was in such doldrums. So I think people needed the escape of going to the Savoy and to those other places to dance. They needed those bands. As an antidote to the Depression, I think swing music did as much as MGM musicals to help America through.
Swing provided Hollywood with its theme music and offered entertainment, elegance, and escape for a people down on their luck. Radios and jukeboxes could be heard playing swing along every main street in America, providing the accompaniment for a host of exhilarating new dances. The Big Apple and Little Peach, the Shag and Susie Q, and the dance that had started it all, the Lindy Hop, now called Jitterbuggin'. Hundreds of bands were on the road, and young people followed the careers of the musicians who played in them, just as they followed their favorite baseball players. Millions of white Americans who had never listened to jazz before suddenly filled ballrooms and theaters all over the country. The Aragon in Chicago, the Alcazar in Baltimore, and the Alibaba in Oakland. The Twilight in Fort Dodge, Iowa, and the Moonlight in Canton, Ohio. The Arcadia Ballroom in Detroit, the Paramount Theater in New York, and the Palomar Ballroom in Los Angeles, where Benny Goodman had thrilled audiences with his version of the music first played by Louis Armstrong, Fletcher Henderson, Chick Webb, and Duke Ellington.
Swing music was an electrifying development in American popular culture. It unleashed forces that I think people didn't know existed. There had been dance bands, sweet bands, sentimental bands. But when Benny Goodman reached those kids at the Palomar Ballroom in California, it was like 20 years later with rock and roll. He was playing a swinging, rough music that had been played in black communities for years. Ellington, you know, wrote "It Don't Mean a Thing If It Ain't Got That Swing" 3 years earlier, and Chick Webb's band was doing it, and Fletcher Henderson's. It swept the country. It unleashed some kind of pent-up excitement and physicality that I think nobody was quite prepared for. Also, this was the Depression. It was not an easy period. And this was a music that was just pure pleasure, pure physical pleasure.
Getting this money out just as fast as we can because we are anxious to get the unemployed from relief rolls onto payroll. We're not only building roads, we're building bridges, we're building dams. It is going into public buildings and various other projects.
Song is the wind chime of memory. And these were our songs. They were part of the daily ordinary. And this, I think, is what took Benny over the gap, out of jazz into the American parlor. He arrived with Blue Skies. Well, we knew Blue Skies. I mean, everybody knew Irving Berlin. So there we were, home free. This is our guy.
Within a month of Benny Goodman's unexpected success at the Palomar, his records stood at number 3, number 2, and number 1 in California record stores. He was 26 years old and already being billed as the king of swing. Suddenly, his music was everywhere. And Goodman, the reticent son of Jewish immigrants from the slums of Chicago, was becoming a matinee idol.
I kind of was in love with Benny Goodman. I don't know why. I thought he looked great. And I loved the way he just stood there and he didn't over, you know, emphasize himself. He was cool. To me, he was a cool guy in my youth. You know, I was 16 years old, 17.
The king of swing. Yes, sir, it's Benny Goodman himself.
And I used to put the radio on at high volume and put my ear to it to hear Gene Krupa. And my mother would go crazy saying, "What are you doing?" I said, "Mom, shh, gotta hear this."
On March 3rd, 1937, Benny Goodman's orchestra began a two-week engagement at the Paramount Theater in Times Square. Until then, they had played hotels and ballrooms where alcohol was served, and the customers were mostly adults. But at the Paramount, everyone was welcome. For the first time, high school students, who had been buying up Benny Goodman's records, now had a chance to see their hero in person.
The moment had come, and they were pouring out of the subways around Times Square in mobs. And the police didn't know what was going on. Where were all these kids coming from? What was it all about?
Music has such an incredible beat that it just brought you out of yourself, and you got out of your seat, and you danced with whoever, stranger you didn't know. But it was just fun to get up and move with that beat.
And the kids started jitterbugging in the aisles, right up around the stage, and some of them even jumping up on the stage. And that was what triggered a great deal of publicity. And Benny Goodman then, although he had been successful, now he had become really an icon, a great hero of popular culture.
Good role model. He comes out, he looks like a gentleman, and then he, in the middle of a clarinet solo, all of a sudden he's got one foot raised and he's hopping around, and he sits down on a chair and he practically falls over it, and he becomes completely consumed in the music. And this is mesmerizing for an audience because it's not a show, it's not a put-on. It's Goodman.
The thing about Benny that was so great was that it was kind of an explosion. He showed up on the scene completely unknown as far as we were concerned. We knew Ellington, we knew all the other big names, and here's this kid nobody'd ever heard of. And overnight, this guy walks into the American parlor with jazz by the scruff of its neck, and all of a sudden, jazz, which was almost a cult music, has become American popular music. And that's what Goodman did.